Good evening, good morning, good afternoon to everybody. I'm Evan Medeiros, Penner Family Chair in Asian Studies here at the School of Foreign Service. It's my pleasure to welcome you to today's webinar titled Unpacking China's Multilateral Initiatives. And I can promise you tonight's discussion will be far more interesting than the title of today's webinar. Over the last several years, China has proposed a trio of very interesting initiatives, the Global Development Initiative, the Global Security Initiative, and the Global Civilizational Initiatives. And in some ways, this set of initiatives is sort of a culmination of Chinese foreign policy principles, but in other ways, it may be something new and might collectively comprise a distinct Chinese vision, Xi Jinping's vision, for global governance. And so we wanted to bring together a very distinguished, very expert panel of scholars and practitioners to unpack this and try and understand what these initiatives are all about. How much is rhetoric? How much is reality? Tonight's event is co-sponsored by the Wall School of Foreign Service Asian Studies Program. That's where I sit. And of course, our good friends at the Initiative for the U.S.-China Dialogue on Global Issues and the Africa-China Initiative, both at Georgetown University. We maintain a very robust community of expertise across the university on China. And so it's fun for me to be able to bring that together. And I want to thank my colleagues in particular, Eleanor Albert, for helping to arrange tonight's webinar. So we've got three fantastic experts who have joined us tonight to talk about it. Let me briefly introduce them in alphabetical order. First, we have Courtney Fung, who's an associate professor in the Department of Security Studies and Criminology at Macquarie University, where I'm told that they run law and order on a loop during the day to sort of keep students focused on criminology. Courtney has a bunch of very distinguished credentials, including an associate research position at the Fairbrick Center for Chinese Studies at Harvard. But of course, her most distinguished one is upcoming. She's coming to Georgetown in the spring of 2024. As a Fulbright scholar, which of course will enrich our community enormously. So Courtney, thanks for joining us tonight from Australia. Next, we have Chris Klein, who is a senior State Department officer, but he's also a fellow at Georgetown University's Institute for the Study of Diplomacy. Chris, I wanna begin by explaining that Chris's views represent his own personal views and not those of the State Department. Chris has had a very, very distinguished career, most recently serving as the Principal Deputy Assistant Secretary for International Organizations. But my favorite of his jobs was he was the Deputy Chief of Mission in the U.S. Embassy in Hanoi, Vietnam, and has endlessly interesting tales about the U.S.-Vietnam relationship. So, Chris, thank you so much for joining us and sharing your personal views. Last but not least, we have Karen Zhu, who's a postdoctoral fellow at the India-China Institute at the New School. She was previously a postdoctoral research fellow at the Global Development Policy Center at Boston University, and her research focuses on the Belt and Road issues and China's economic actor. So we're going to start with Courtney and ask Courtney to talk a little bit about where did this alphabet soup come from? Global Development Initiative, Global Security Initiative, and Global Civilizational Initiative. How do they fit into China's foreign policy strategy? How are they being promoted? And sort of what's your take, Courtney? Is this old wine in a new bottle, as the Chinese like to say? Or do we actually, might we actually have some glimmer of a new strategy by Xi Jinping? And then we'll go from Courtney to Karen to Chris. Now, let me just say before we turn it over to Courtney, that for all of you that are watching or listening, please use the Q&A function at the bottom of the screen if you've got questions. We're going to leave it about 30 minutes at the end of our 90-minute discussion to do Q&A. So, Courtney, please, over to you.
Many thanks to both Evan and Eleanor for hosting and organizing the session, and I look forward to the discussion. So hello, hello, everyone. Good morning from Sydney. And I think I'd like to begin with sort of a very broad scene setter. We've had now a decade of the Belt and Road Initiative and about a decade of Xi Jinping's language about there being this community of common destiny, i.e. China's vision for how global governance and the global governance system should be organized. Chinese officials are becoming clearer, as we saw just before the start of this latest UN General Assembly session. If you thought the title of your webinar was kind of wordy, Evan, I have a wordier one for you, that China released its proposal on reform and development of global governance. That was earlier in September of this year, in which there was a very clear view that China had taken this idea to action. This community of common destiny is being enacted now, and it's taken its vision for a reformed global governance system that reflects the multipolarity that China is so convinced has arrived, has taken this vision into reality. So on this question of whether or not we're really looking at, with these three new GSI, GDI, GCI, if we're really looking at something new, I would argue perhaps we are. I think we're looking at a new phase of China's engagement with the multilateral system. China is very clear that the UN is an important foundational element for the way that multilateral politics should occur. It wants to be clear that it views the UN as a space in which it can tame US power, as of course the G2 relationship is very important, but also wants to present itself as an active reformer of the global governance system. So it's one thing to be the second largest budget funder in the regular budget. It's another thing to be giving highlighted major initiatives. So for example, the Global Peace and Development Trust Fund, but actually the real push is the ability to inject ideas and programs into the UN system. And that's what we're seeing with the push with GDI in September of 2021, kind of like a rejoinder to getting the 2030 SDGs back on track, given our post-COVID time. We also see this push in April of 2022 with the Global Security Initiative. In many ways, China's first real push into articulating a clearer stance about its views for security order. We've seen for decades now, China's language that it's clear that it does not appreciate certain elements of a Western-led security order. The double standards of the rules, the fact that attempts at promoting liberal nation building have arrived with greater problems, like we see in Afghanistan, Iraq, Libya, and Syria as the well-oft cited examples. And so this is a real departure for China to be coming out with security articulation first, getting a step clearer to what it sees as being important, and somehow it's going to reconcile CCP regime security, the UN Charter, deflecting criticism on Ukraine, common security and collective security. And again, we've seen a push starting in this year, February of 2023, that we've seen this push now for a concept paper in which many things fall into the GSI concept paper, but it's also quite surprising the things that don't. So women, peace, and security, for example, have fallen off the table. And along with this, at the start of the year, we've also seen this reference now to a global civilizational initiative. So much more language about the relevance of a relative understanding of human rights, the importance of individual state civilizational experiences, histories, society, and political systems that are meant to give us all the complete, unique starting point in which we engage with global governance. The flip side of this is to really push back on the idea that there is such a thing as a universal standard, i.e. universal human rights, universal values like accountability, equality, things like this. I think I'd like to point out, just before I sort of begin to try and wrap up, it's really important to note that we really are at the infancy with these new global public goods. In many ways, they're broad and flexible, just like we saw with BRI over the last decade. There have been many versions of BRI that occur and will be very well placed to speak to. But I think we're at the point now that we are seeing these global public goods as an attempt by Beijing to promote its own particular universalist, exceptionalist attitude to global politics, and its ability to sort of elide the own shortcomings in China's own governance systems in sort of promoting these particular broad initiatives. I should note that we have a few things to think about as a group. First off, I think to better understand what really participation in these initiatives looks like. So China will cite that there's a group of friends for GDI that has at one count over 100 participants. Some counts have as small as 40, other counts have 70. They'll be very keen to point out that there's verbal rhetorical support from multiple senior UN officials, including the Secretary General himself. So what does that mean to really participate? Who gets to be in, who gets to be out? We've all seen the FT's reporting about attempts by certain Western states to have some type of GDI participation that was perhaps shunted aside by Beijing. I think a second thing to also consider, as I flagged, is what exactly counts as sort of being within the fold of these initiatives. So GSI almost has something for all type of security experts, counterterrorism, anti-separatism, peace operations, rule of law, security sector reform, nuclear issues, all kind of fall in, but then there's also the issues that maybe haven't. So again, on my own top read, women, peace and security gets a rather short shrift. So I think there's that question mark for us to consider. And then I think, again, the last thing to think about is why it's these three initiatives that get mentioned as a trio and not all four, including the BRI, or even other global initiatives. So China floated in September of 2020, the Global Initiative on Data Security. And for some reason, it doesn't seem to quite make this pantheon. It doesn't seem to come into the fold when they talk about the major global public goods that China's offering. So I think I'll maybe leave my remarks there, and I very much look forward to the discussion. And Evan, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Great. Well, thank you, Courtney. A typically articulate, thoughtful, well-structured, and brief comment. So Courtney, let me follow up on a couple things. I'm going to pick up on the final point you made. So you've got the three that you outlined, plus now you mentioned the data initiative, and you've got BRI. So the Chinese say, oh, we're just trying to reform the structure of global governance, right? We're not trying to revise it. How should we think about reform versus revision? Isn't one man's reform really another man's revision? Or couldn't China incrementally over time sufficiently change aspects of the international order in such a way that we wake up in 15 years and find out that the rules-based order has actually been substantially changed in a way more consistent with Chinese interests?
That's a great question. So thank you, Evan. I think we can talk about a few things. I mean, I think it's becoming clear that China is looking to reform the UN system from within. Parallel supportive institutions like the AIIB are vying for status as recognized multilateral, multinational development banks. They're not looking to be seen as an extension of Chinese development policy. But again, AIIB is meant to be in support of the crown jewel, which is, of course, the UN-led institutions. China's very clear that these UN institutions don't just implement policy, they also are key focal points for actual design of policy, so therefore they're very important. I think we have to remember a few things, that to point out that China has a really great alley-oop in terms of the lack of enthusiasm for where this round of global governance has taken us. Whether we talk about economic reform, whether we talk about sort of broad nation building, liberal internationalism, question marks about to what extent global governance issues have been resolved without taking into account the South-South views, centering South-South views, or really asking about how sovereignty has been abused by certain key players. So I think there's a groundswell of states, certainly in the global South, that are at least ears open and amenable to hearing about a revised system. We also have, frankly, have a Secretary General that has a lot more to say about bureaucratic reform, the use of AI, the need to get the 2030 SDGs back on track, and perhaps less to say about human rights first. So I think, again, there is this sort of opening within the global governance structures and the global governance players that gives space for a player like China that is full of new ideas and also full of real funding to drive these ideas forward. I think we also have to note too that when we talk about the broad avenues open to us, there are some of these SDGs, for example, that are viewed as being quote unquote apolitical. Access to water, for example, is not as controversial as sort of linking fundamental human rights in terms of promoting development. But I think we also have to be realistic here. When we talk about this reform versus revisionist debate, in its extreme, if China was to be an unfettered success, and this would take decades and decades and decades to track this, to monitor this and to see this change, I think we really would see a very different international system. China is very clear now, it is looking to promote a bi-state, four-state led international system. So for example, even on issues that have been traditionally ones that are multi-stakeholder, like cyber, like environment, there is a real push for China to say that These non-state players are welcome to discuss, they are welcome to convene, but when it comes to actual policy design and implementation, this is states first. And this language about GCI that could fit into UNESCO, it could fit into the Human Rights Council, it could fit into a multitude of UN spaces, really is pushing back on the idea of there being fundamental universal human rights, which are key in the way that the UN in this current iteration promotes human security. So I think we do have to have our eyes open, even though I think in the best case scenario, this could be a change that could take place over decades. And of course, we're in a very switched on set of players now that are very aware, keenly following what is going on in the global governance space. But I'll stop here.
Now, so Courtney, would you say that China's intention actually is to substantially revise the rules-based order, but that they're probably unlikely to be successful in any sort of reasonable timeframe because there is so much attention and awareness of what they're trying to do? Is that sort of where you're going?
I think that's the great summary. This is why you need to be on this panel. You took the academic's 5-minute throat clearing and said it in a sentence. I do think that's where things are, but I think we also have to remember, I mean, even as of 2-3 years ago, there was a lot less attention paid to this space. And then suddenly states like the United States, states like Germany started to realize that strategic competition in the UN space was actually real. And if they were worried about it, they needed to start turning up and paying attention. And so, for example, the US-led campaign to sort of fend off the Chinese candidate in WIPO is seen as one of those high watermarks. I think if you're on that side of the equation. Yeah. Sorry?
WIPO for our listeners?
Oh, pardon me. The World Intellectual Property Organization, right, that China had a very, very strong candidate and ran an extremely strong campaign, but still could not manage to secure that particular candidacy. And again, given the emphasis and the interest in AI, technological revolution as really furthering economic growth, development, and security in our millennia, I think that was seen as a key agency if China was able to head it. But again, this is an example of what happens when other states come as prepared and as organized as China is to actually compete.
But that's an excellent point. But you also pointed out that Chinese views have a lot of resonance within the global South. So one question that's always perplexed me is the Chinese tie themselves to the UN system, but yet when it comes to the most sacrosanct principle at the heart of the UN system, right, which is the inviolability of borders, the Chinese are decidedly ambivalent or ambiguous. The Russian invasion of Ukraine, both in 2014 and in 2022, being obvious examples. Why doesn't that undercut or constrain China's ability to hug the UN system as a model of global governance?
I mean, you've hit the million-dollar question. I mean, I think, again, you know, China's very clear that it supports the United Nations, the principles of international law, the UN institutions. It doesn't mean, like any other great state, that China is going to be constrained by them. I mean, we can simply look at all of the fallout following the arbitration ruling vis-a-vis the Philippines and China, that this is certainly not something where China is feeling constrained. I think, again, though, we can see variation within the global South. If we take the case of ASEAN, which has been relatively mute on questions of GSI in Ukraine, we really do see Singapore has taken a leading edge in terms of asking repeatedly, how do concepts like the Russian language about there being common security, how is that reconciled with collective security? As a smaller player, what should we be thinking in a space where there's obviously a large neighbor nearby? I think, again, there's been a number of states that have asked the same type of question repeatedly. And at this point, I haven't heard any real clear understanding about how Chinese officials are trying to reconcile things that appear, at least in the Venn diagram, to not really be touching. Again, this common security versus collective security point.
Right.
I think we also, just one last thing on this, though, as we talk about sort of China's ability to manage sovereignty questions, there is also this very broad understanding about what sovereignty means. So I think we can also track at the General Assembly wavering support, for example, on Ukraine about there being a war register, wavering support about, you know, again, led by other key players in the global South, like South Africa, calling out, you know, Russian accountability. Again, you can sort of track how these resolution numbers move. And so I think, again, this gold standard about sort of protecting sovereignty at all counts itself is also something that's, again, open to question amongst a number of self-identified global South players.
Mm-hmm. Courtney, one final question. I want to double tap on GSI. So when you read the content of GSI, it doesn't, on its face, doesn't really look like anything different than a sort of souped up version of the five principles of peaceful coexistence. So is there anything, what am I missing about GSI that sort of makes it distinct and would be a sort of Chinese view of international security? Or are there elements of it in practice that you believe are going to be significant? What should we take away from GSI?
Well, I think the first takeaway, thank you, Evan, for the question. The first takeaway is that the in practice part is still open. I mean, it's literally just moved to concept paper phase. I think if we have the conversation 2 or 3 years from now, we'll have a much better understanding of what Chinese officials are doing. I would note, I think, again, exactly as you say, that it's maybe it reads a little bit more to some as old wine in old bottles. I think it's also important to point out that there's a lot of rehatting of existing initiatives that were already ongoing well before GSI are now being called GSI initiatives. So China's long track record in terms of supporting UN peacekeeping is now taken as an example of GSI. The UN Peace and Development Trust Fund announced back in 2015 by Xi Jinping himself is now taken as an example of GSI. I would say though, that I really do hold to this idea that at least rhetorically it is different in the sense that Beijing is now moving away from saying, but I don't like this and I'm forced to have to support it. I don't like having to do things that back the Americans in ways that I feel more obliged to than I would. And I've done a lot of research about China's voting regarding Libya and Syria, for example, as issues, as intervention issues coming through the Security Council that tracks with this as these examples. That GSI is different in the sense that China can at least articulate a little bit clearer now what it is thinking as its own solutions. Again, as we can see, sometimes these solutions are contradictory. Common security and collective security is that great example, but they are in there. And I think the last thing to also point out, I would wager at least, that the timing of GSI is in part a reflection of China's own awareness that its initial rhetoric regarding Ukraine had fallen flat. Mm. And I think the attempts to reconcile A and B may not always be coming from this great position of sort of intellectual strength. And again, this idea that they've taken a vision from a decade ago and made it a reality under Xi Jinping. I think there also is this awareness, it's not entirely tone deaf or has a tin ear, an awareness that some of the initial positions that China put forward on Ukraine had not gone down so well. And that there was an attempt with this GSI to try and reconcile many, many things at once. Again, really trying to present China as a globally minded leading reformer working within the system to develop this multipolar system that many other players would enjoy. Now, again, the jury's out, and I'm sure we could have this discussion over the next coming years to see in practice what that looks like in terms of things that are quote unquote new and not simply, in my own take, rehatted.
Yeah. Well, Courtney, thank you so much. I appreciate you indulging all the questions from the chair. Chris, you'll remember Jiang Zemin's new security concept from 1997-1998, which of course immediately sprang to mind when I first read Xi Jinping's GSI speech, but we'll get there. Karen, we're really anxious to bring you into the conversation to talk a little bit in more depth about GDI, right? Courtney sort of set the stage with Chinese views of global governance. We spent some time on GSI. Now, the Global Development Initiative, sort of where did it come from? What's China trying to do? And most importantly, how should we think about it in relation to BRI?
Thank you very much, Evan. These are a great set of questions. So the GDI, which is the Global Development Initiative, was proposed in September 2021. And there are 8 key domains that are to be implemented, including poverty reduction, food security, vaccination, development finance, climate change, green development, industrialization, digital economy, and connectivity. And so actually, if we look at GDI, it is really like very much aligned with existing Chinese development outreach overseas. As Courtney has mentioned, it is really consistent and has lots of consistent with the UN 2030 Sustainable Development Goals. And there were actually lots of convergence there. the official language was that the delay in SDG attainment was largely because of the global pandemic and the Russian-Ukraine conflict. So like the timing of the GDI is really important in that regard, in that it was proposed in 2021 and touched on burning concerns facing global development, such as poverty reduction, digital development, connectivity, food security, energy transition, climate change, and public health. And the specific focus is on the vulnerable states and vulnerable population. And in terms of the cooperation domains, compared with past development initiatives China has proposed, it really has a growing emphasis on green, inclusive, and sustainable development. And also it has a growing emphasis on the vulnerable population. And there are also some concerns that are like emerging needs, such as the digital economy. One thing that I'm not sure if it's a coincidence is that actually a few months after the proposal of the Build Back Better World, and which also contains much of green development and digital economy, the GDI was proposed. So I don't know to what extent we should view it as a form of competition for influence between China and the US. And in terms of a resource mobilization for the GDI, so there is a $10 billion US dollar added to the Fund for Global Development and South-South Cooperation with the introduction of the GDI. And there are also growing forms of cooperation, also adding more multilateral cooperation on top of existing forms of cooperation. So the GDI, from this regard, really views China's China's attempt in a more multidimensional approach to its development cooperation. And there is also with its emphasis on South-South cooperation, there is a growing emphasis on the importance in China's engagement with the global South. And Evan, you have mentioned the Belt and Road Initiative and this connection with the GDI. So the official statement based on one of the spokesperson from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs is that both initiatives are dedicated to promoting win-win in international cooperation, but the two initiatives are self-contained. They have different emphasis and different cooperation direction and different focus of cooperation. So if I'm to summarize the similarities and differences, I would say that the similarities is that both the BRI and the GDI are geared towards development and prosperity, and they are both aligned with the UN development goals. And they are also seek to be as inclusive as possible in nature. But I also see lots of differences. For example, in terms of the nature of cooperation, the BRI is largely a global economic governance initiative, and based on my discussion with the experts in China, and they actually view the BRI more in a bilateral sense. So that is it is building on bilateral relations. And whereas the GDI focuses more on international multilateral institutions, and there is a much more heavy emphasis on the role of the United Nations and United Nations development goals. And in terms of the domains of cooperation, the Belt and Road, at least at its initial stage when it was proposed, has been largely focused on physical infrastructure. And in the Western context, it is largely conceived as a physical infrastructure initiative. Whereas as to the GDI, infrastructure is still there if we look at the publicized project list, but actually very much of it is capacity building around infrastructure. That is, it has really shifted towards a softer approach to development rather than focusing on physical infrastructure. And in terms of the countries of coverage, BRI has a much more all-encompassing approach, and now having already over 150 participants. The GDI right now still largely focused on South-South cooperation. And And so the comparison actually, based on my research, actually shows that from what GDI has been proposed, like what was proposed in GDI, like China really has learned its lessons in the one decade of implementation of the BRI. So BRI, when it was announced, the objectives and there was never a clear list of projects that were actually issued by official sources. And the projects were really broad and loosely defined. And the process of informing the public is rather opaque. And yet for the GDI, actually there has been like a clear public release of a list of defined projects. And there is also a transition from BRI's more expansive cooperation network to a more focused approach to South-South cooperation within the GDI, and also a trend from BRI's emphasis on large-scale economic infrastructure to GDI's focus on small and beautiful social infrastructure. And they, if you view the BRI from a strategic point of view, GDI is more of a development-oriented initiative. So really, the focuses are different. And so while some may interpret these changes from GDI, from BRI to GDI as a reduction of China's international ambition, I think it is probably just, we are just witnessing a transforming stage of China's foreign engagement from a all-expensive approach to a more surgical approach, seeking to increase more efficacy.
So Karen, would you say that GDI and BRI, would you characterize them as largely complementary or competitive? I couldn't quite tell from your presentation.
I would say that they, to a certain extent, are complementary in that they have different domains of focus, whereas the Belt and Road definitely has its economic governance perspective, and it also has its strategic roots, whereas the GDI is primarily a development-focused perspective. And in terms of the country of coverage, it is also the BRI has a more expansive outreach, whereas the GDI focuses more on South-South cooperation. From my discussion with some experts in China, some largely distinguished the two as BRI being largely bilateral focused and the GDI being growingly multilateral focused.
Mm-hmm. So you think both are going to continue to exist? In 10 years, you think we'll continue to have both initiatives?
It is really interesting. That's a very interesting question in that just based on official channels, such as the recently held Third Belt and Road Forum, we can see that obviously the Belt and Road is still going on, and there are lots of memorandum of understanding that were signed, and it is not going away in the next 10 years. However, based on my discussions in the field with stakeholders in developing countries and with friends who actually work in some state-owned enterprises, what they are telling me is that there is a less and less mentioning of BRI. So I think probably it's a withdrawal at the project level, but at the diplomatic foreign policy making level, BRI is not going away.
Interesting. So let's talk a little bit more about the GDI. What are some examples of practical behavior on the part of Chinese that we can point to? We all know what BRI is, right? They're building roads, bridges, right? Soccer stadiums, all of that. What about GDI? What are practical things GDI is doing that can help us understand what it's all about? Or I think you're muted, Karen. Yep, you're on mute.
So the GDI publish is a project list, which really contains projects like that that are like in, that covers the eight domains that are outlined as its key strategic domains. And GDI projects can be, for example, it's largely focused on capacity building. Take the example of infrastructure development. Instead of really building a road for a country, there is like training for people in terms of infrastructure development. So the focus is much more on the social side, on the livelihood side.
Interesting. So would you say GDI is more about capacity building as opposed to funding specific projects?
I would not say that, because given the eight domains that are outlined, development finance and other domains remain very important. I think what China is doing, like what Courtney has mentioned, seems to be just rebranding much of the existing projects, existing corporation in, and also giving them a different hat. And these corporations may have been well into implementation. And so we are not really sure if it's because of GDI that led to this foci on social development, or it's just because that they simply categorize or just lump all these projects together.
I see. Interesting. And what about how should we think about sort of, you know, GDI in the context of big debates over China as the largest creditor and China contributing to unsustainable debt burdens, right? We read about Ecuador and Zambia, you know, facing, you know, basically facing default and having to renegotiate. So how does GDI sort of connect with that? How does debt sustainability come into the GDI orbit?
That's another great question. So the way to think of it is that GDI in part is a policy learning experience based on the 10 years of experience that's largely focused on mega project development. So China definitely has learned this lesson in investment in large infrastructure projects, which really resulted in varied outcomes. And these projects bear lots of risks. And since then, China has, like in the infrastructure domain, has taken a approach that's what we call a small and beautiful approach. In a way, if we look at the project scale within the GDI, that definitely follows the small and beautiful approach. And in terms of the debt that you have mentioned, I would not. I think the development finance component of the GDI definitely would seek to identify some solutions for these debt crises. But it's not just the GDI that's solving the problem. China is resorting to many multinational institutions in negotiating a solution for these debt crises.
Mm-hmm. So to clarify, so GDI projects are small and beautiful, and the implication being that BRI projects are big and not so beautiful. Is that what we should take away? Big and ugly, small and beautiful?
BRI projects at their initial stage are big and ambitious with varied outcomes. I would put it that way.
Okay. Very, very well said. Very well said. Okay. Let's bring Chris into the conversation. Chris, we've looked at, you know, the initiatives, what China's seeks to do, what China's practically doing. And we'd love to get your views on the flip side of the coin, which is how are these initiatives being received by other countries, including the United States, right? Do they impact how other countries look at China? So their bilateral relationship with China, is China this sort of great new partner? Is China really making headway in redefining norms of development and security globally? How should we think about the international community's response to the alphabet soup?
Well, thanks a lot. I really appreciate your organizing this event. Thanks to you and thanks to Eleanor, and it's really an honor to join you all. And before I start, I want to say, Evan and Karen and Courtney, I've been a big fan of each of you for a really long time. So it's pretty great. And I also think that it's such an appropriate time to have this discussion, given what we've seen in San Francisco over the last couple of days. So thanks for that. Listen, you all have been really insightful already, and I've learned a lot. So I think I'm going to be pretty brief so we can get to the Q&A. But let me start with sort of how the initiatives are being received by the United States and by other countries. And obviously, I'll have more insight into the United States perspective. But you know, I would say in general that it's safe to say that there's some skepticism on our part in the United States, and there's also skepticism among some other liberal open countries that we consider partners. You know, I think it's possible that we view the initiatives as vehicles for China over time to reshape the system, as Courtney was talking about, around some principles that are much more comfortable for the Communist Party of China and for the PRC. But at the same time, the initiatives themselves raise some questions for us about China's goals. So for example, with the GDI, is China trying to line up the GDI to be really the successor to the 2030 agenda and the Sustainable Development Goals? And you know, if so, listen, there could be good elements to it. You know, there were things that Courtney mentioned that Karen mentioned that could make a lot of sense. But for the United States, and I think for a lot of our partners and friends, you know, any elements of a new UN blueprint document would need to be transparently discussed and negotiated. And that hasn't been the case so far on a lot of these things. So I can't really speak for other countries, but some of the evidence that we've seen is that there are signs that the G77, which is actually a 134 country bloc in the United States that includes China, they self-identify as developing countries, they've gotten a little bit tired of the fights between the United States and China in the UN multilateral context, especially with respect to catchphrases. And in fact, China has been using and trying to insert catchphrases into resolutions and other UN documents a lot less in recent years. You know, and by the catchphrases, I'm talking about things like building a common shared future for mankind and true multilateralism and that sort of thing. And I think that the government of China realized that, and they realized that the middle countries are getting tired of being caught in the middle. And so I think that has translated, as Courtney was saying, into more of a focus on the initiatives themselves, as opposed to sort of resolution by resolution, getting Xi Jinping thought into texts. But what I want to say really also is that basically for the United States, you know, whether or not the substance of GDI or GSI or GCI, and I want to talk about that a tiny bit, but whether or not there's validity in some aspects of it, you know, that's one question. But for us, we do not believe that the UN itself should be in the business of endorsing any one country's political, economic, or social policies. And we really see that as undermining the UN Charter. And what we have found in our soundings is that many countries agree with us about that. Now, what effect are these initiatives having in the multilateral system right now, and particularly at the UN? I really agree with what my co-panelists have said, and that I think it's too early to say. I think that it is true that the UN is built on four pillars, right? Peace and security, human rights, development, and rule of law. And what we've seen so far is that China's actions have indicated that they're trying to elevate two of the pillars and knock two down. And what I mean specifically by that is, if you look at the UN's Peace and Development Trust Fund, which Courtney mentioned, it was created in 2016 with $200 million in seed money from the PRC. And I think all you have to do is look at the title of it. It's not the Human Rights and Rule of Law Trust Fund. It's Peace and Security and Development. And, you know, I think that that's only one way that China is trying to influence the system. I think that Courtney hit upon something that was really important, which is personnel. And personnel moves are really important. I was talking to a friend yesterday who works in diplomacy and with the UN a lot. And she said that that strategy is personnel and personnel is strategy. And I think that's really true. And the PRC has done a really good job over the recent decades in placing its people at all levels of the organization, from junior professionals up to the senior levels. And there are PRC nationals who are the heads of important UN bodies like the Food and Agricultural Organization and the UN Department of Economic and Social Affairs. And I'm not saying that that's always bad or that we disagree with these leaders on everything. There are things where we do see eye to eye. But these positions do give the PRC nationals the opportunity to set the agenda. And in some cases, they have a seat at the Secretary General's executive board table, which, you know, is appropriate. But the point is, they're there when decisions about policy and priorities are made. Now, how is the United States responding to this? And how should we respond to this? For us, what I've seen is that we continue to push back against the insertion of the catchphrases where we see them, or references to the initiatives in UN documents, such as from resolution texts, but also from World Food Program, country strategic plans, that sort of thing. It's something that the United States tries hard to do. And we have a lot of partners on that. We can't simply, though, declare that a proposal is bad just because it comes from China. And knee-jerk reactions just don't work. And it puts the middle in a bad spot. And honestly, it's frustrating for diplomats on the ground who try to drum up support for US positions. There has to be more to it. And so what we believe, and I think this has gained some resonance, is that in negotiations, we've pointed out that China's proposals are inconsistent with important UN blueprint documents like the Charter and the 2030 Agenda. And we've gained some traction with that approach. Now, not saying that that some elements of GDI are not supportive of the SDGs, but at the same time, inserting language and trying to elevate it as something that we do have questions about, especially if the result is to accentuate the importance of development over things like human rights and rule of law. We don't think it's appropriate to cherry pick the pillars. We also have made it pretty clear that that we don't support UN officials showing up and speaking at events when it seems to endorse one country's foreign or domestic policy initiatives. I wanted to say just a quick word about the GSI and how one of the things that we've noticed is that it's absolutely true that it's early days, and we have not seen the PRC trying to insert references to GSI or make a big thing of GSI in the UN context so far. But that doesn't mean we're not watching out the United States and many of its partners. And in part, it's because of one of the six principles of GSI, which is indivisible security. And indivisible security, what it basically means is that small countries should not form alliances that threaten big powers. I mean, that's basically the bottom line. And that's what Putin pointed to as one of the pretexts for his further invasion of Russia. And so our concern with the GSI is that it's really a tacit, maybe even less than tacit, sign of approval for what Putin did by attacking Ukraine. And with respect to the GCI, I think that's an important one to keep an eye on as well, because it elevates the importance of civilizations and peoples, and it downplays human rights at the individual level, and it also downplays the obligations of governments to safeguard them. Now, I want to safeguard our time, so I think I'm going to stop there and just turn it back over to you, Evan, and see if there's anything that we can follow up on.
Yeah, thank you, Chris. That was wonderful. And I do have a couple follow-ups. Chris, let me just ask you, just for a little bit of color, wake everybody up. You served at the U.S. mission to the UN in New York, right?
Yeah.
Tell us what years you served there and what was it really like working with the Chinese? Pull the veil off a little bit, right? And of course, you were there before GSI and GDI and all that. But like, how did the Chinese operate at the UN, Chris?
Well, it was really fascinating. Thank you for asking that, because I served there from 2000 to 2002. First as the staff assistant for Ambassador Holbrook, and then I worked in the political section handling Security Council issues and General Assembly issues. But then I went back from 2013 to 2017, and I was the head of the political section there. So I spent so many hours, countless hours in the Security Council, and you see I have my UN helmet to protect me from some of the abuse that I would get as the U.S. representative there.
Sometimes. Yeah, that looks like a formidable helmet. That's going to protect you from a lot, no doubt. So, Chris, let's focus on your second time, more recent, 2013 and 2017.
Right.
What were the big issues on the table?
Well, I think there were a number. I would say Ukraine was a big one.
Sure.
Also Syria. And North Korea as well. North Korea did conduct nuclear tests, and
it
also
never fails to disappoint, does it, Chris?
Absolutely, it's
North
always
Koreans
there.
Always deliver a good show at the UN, don't they?
Always do. They pick good times to do it, often corresponding to long weekends. But in all seriousness, that was an area where the United States and China had to work very, very closely together. And I would say that my experience with working with Chinese diplomats at the UN was actually pretty good. My sense was they were very professional, very well prepared, and constructive when they could be, and they were good at negotiating. They were tough. They knew their red lines. But if you have an image of them as being, you know, rote readers of guidance from Beijing, that's a mistake. The diplomats who I worked with they took on board some of our suggestions and they would try to sell it back in Beijing. There were times when we disagreed, and it was often very, very much on North Korea. You know, Syria and Ukraine, that was kind of a Russia show. And I thought it was very interesting. I think it's important for us not always to assume that Russia and China are always in terrific communication. Now, I think that's changed since I left in 2017.
You mean better communication now? Is that more
better communication now? But when I was there, there were times when we were working on Syria resolutions with the council, and the Russians and I we were in very close consultation. And my Chinese colleagues would come up and say, "Hey, could you tell us where you guys are? Because the Russians aren't answering our calls right now." So, and that wasn't gamesmanship. I think it was real. So I actually found it that you know, we didn't agree on everything. We had some, you know, some difficult moments, particularly when the United States held the first meeting in the Security Council on human rights in North Korea, but that led to a very rare procedural vote. But at the same time, it was a time when I felt that we could work very, very well and very closely together. My understanding, and I did talk to some people before speaking with you all today, is that that's changed a lot. It's harder for the United States and China to come together in New York. You know, I have faith that that can change back. And I think that there are things that we can work together on, but—
So why do you have faith it'll change back, Chris?
Well, because I do believe that, I believe that there are issues where we simply have no choice but to work together. And I do think North Korea is one of them. But in addition to that, there are areas, you know, it's important to realize that the Security Council does adopt 30, 40, 50, 60 resolutions a year. And the United States and China, you know, vote similarly on 90% of 99% of them, I would say. And so we can work in areas that might not be necessarily quite as sensitive in Africa to, you know, to our bilateral relationship. But also, I think North Korea is going to be the gift that keeps on giving. And even though we saw a veto for the first time in a really long time last May, it was May of 2022, it was China and Russia jointly vetoed a Security Council resolution that would have tightened sanctions on North Korea. And it was the first veto of a North Korea-related resolution since
after a ballistic missile test, I believe, right?
And it was an ICBM.
Violation.
Yeah, right. It was an ICBM, so it was a clear violation. But, you know, it could be a different story with a nuclear test. You know, and so I feel like, especially given the tone of the meetings over the last couple of days, you know, that can sometimes translate into better connections in New York too.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a really interesting conversation to have. We won't have it now, but about how the Chinese are looking at Russia-North Korea cooperation, including the military technical cooperation,
right,
and whether or not, you know, how that's affecting Chinese perceptions of North Korea and how that may affect Chinese behavior.
Right.
And coordination at the UN Security Council. Chris, let me ask you one final question. As a senior State Department official, you spent a lot of time at the UN. How do you think about GSI, right? Is this something sort of real and substantial, right? Do you see evidence that Chinese trying to operationalize it, or is it basically just rebranding all the old stuff?
Well, you know, I I'm not sure yet. I've looked at, you know, the principles of it, and I haven't seen it in the UN context yet. One of the things that gives me pause, though, is that I know China really prizes its status as a P5 member, and that being a part of that club is important. And I am not sure that Beijing has made a decision to promote GSI in a way that might detract in any way from their position of veto holding prestige on the Security Council that gives them a lot of face. So I just think it's too early to say, and I just haven't seen anything yet.
So, question for you and everybody else. So then how should we reconcile? You've got the GSI clearly still evolving, right? And then, you know, Chinese security cooperation globally is changing, right? Chinese have one military base, trying to get multiple other military bases. The Chinese are emerging as a major military technical cooperation partner with, you know, militaries in the Middle East. The Saudis, the Emiratis come to mind in particular. So there's sort of GSI, and then there's practically what the Chinese were doing. Is there a way to reconcile these two? Because when you look at behavior, it looks like China is acting like what a modern military does, that has a very advanced defense industrial complex, which is use that as a tool to build security relationships. Any reactions to that from anybody? Anyone?
Well, go ahead.
Chris, Chris, you go first, because I'll have the typical rejoinder. So Chris, you go ahead.
No, I mean, I think it's a really tough question, and you've hit on it. You know, China is now the second largest donor to the UN peacekeeping budget. Not a donor; they're assessed 15% of the budget, and so they're the second biggest. And so, yeah, it's absolutely true that they also are the biggest donor of peacekeeping troops. You know, they have units in some pretty hot places like South Sudan, and to be fair, that's something the United States and our partners were encouraging China to do 10 years ago. And so, you know, now they're doing it. You know, with respect to the GSI, I think that before I can answer whether or not it's reconcilable with what China is currently doing, or if there are going to be any differences or changes in tack, I think I just got to see more about what, you know, what it involves.
Courtney?
So I think I'll have a slightly different take than Chris. And I think, of course, still landing on this, seeing where it goes. But I think we can again point out to the successes that China claims are part of GSI. I mean, the Saudi-Iran peace deal, China makes a point that this is an exemplar of China's GSI. They were there for that three-way handshake. But I think, again, you'd be hard-pressed to find a specialist in Middle East, Gulf-China relations that would tell you that China had somehow actually brokered this deal. It was invited in at the correct time, once the players themselves had determined that this was the correct moment to invite in China. I think, again, we can also look at China's, you know, ideas about peace for Ukraine, the repeated efforts by a number of players to draw China in to actually articulate and mobilize what that looks like. If you've already been told that players do not want to have a freeze with where assets are in the field at the moment. And again, you know, China's been very clear to demur, very keen to do the shuttle diplomacy part, but then to demur in the actual hard work of getting to a version of yes, we're still sort of waiting. I think, again, the same thing on Gaza, where Chinese officials themselves have been on the record saying that China has ideas. It's very busy having its special envoy moving around the region, having bilateral meetings elsewhere. But again, China itself is aware it is not the key to this solution. So I think as much as we think about GSI exactly for the, you know, the implications that you're raising, right, these actual facts on the ground are changing. A military bases are being opened, a Navy is becoming far more of a blue fleet than it was even 10, 15 years ago. I think we have to recognize the change in narrative and also again, ask ourselves, are the other facts on the ground moving too? And in many ways, if GSI is a rhetorical push to lead, we have to also ask whether or not there is the change on the ground to actually lead. And again, in these very hot conflicts that Chris has raised, these very tricky peacekeeping missions, I think on that particular patch, we can also see that China has been very hesitant with its innovations for how peacekeeping can become more effective. So I think, again, we are in this sort of space. And I would just like to point out the question that you didn't ask, Evan, but I know you would be liking to ask if I could try and get half a step ahead. I think we also have to remember too that GSI, as much as there is this concept paper, multiple references to the United Nations, China has gone about promoting this bilaterally and with a raft of usual suspects. So with Syria, with the Philippines, with players that maybe are able to have a conversation with China, frankly, but they're not the major players. So I think we have to also bear this in mind that it is running different, and perhaps it is for exactly the reasons that Chris has raised, that there has been effective counter diplomacy to try and highlight what these changes might mean or why the UN should be quote unquote endorsing particular national initiatives. So I think it is very different in terms of, for example, the GDI group of friends explicitly being tied to major UN events, minus the Chinese ambassador himself referencing GSI in his speeches at the council. There isn't really a clear indicator yet that it's been fastened to any other non-Chinese led moments, which is, I think, exactly what Chris had mentioned half a minute ago. Thanks.
Thank you, Courtney. Well, let's see. It's a little past top of the hour. So why don't we go to Q&A. So I've got a bunch of questions here and I'm going to just work through them systematically. So the first question, very straightforward. Would the panelists comment on the content of the Global Civilizational Initiative? What is it? What is its impact? And is this a Chinese effort to undermine the rules-based order? Who'd like to take that one on? We haven't really dug too much into the GCI. So is it an effort? Courtney, you sort of went there a little bit in your presentation, sort of suggesting that the Chinese are trying to undermine universalist principles. How do you see GCI?
I really look at GCI as one of those, I mean, I think it has a lot of potential to have actual change. We have to remember that China's real success in the 1990s, when it was a far weaker economic player in the UN system, in the global system writ large, that China had a major foreign policy success in terms of really emphasizing its own preferences and many states' preferences for economic and social rights being as important as civil and political rights. But I would look at GCI exactly for the reasons that Chris raises already as being quite a different take. I mean, this emphasis on sort of larger civilizational entities, this idea now that states are the real units in which we should try and understand how human rights are understood, and the real emphasis, the repeated emphasis on relativism. that my relative experience, my socioeconomic trajectory determines in many ways the type of human rights and the type of standards I should be asked to do, and the lack of reference at all to sort of the human scale. I think, again, you know, we're seeing a lot of competition. There's the elections going forward now for the board, the governing board for UNESCO. And I think that will also be one of those spaces where we can watch whether or not GCI is tied to, because, again, UNESCO deals with a lot of educational, scientific, social issues obviously come through that space. And again, questions of how GCI will be raised and tied to China's greater push at the UN Human Rights Council, again, to emphasize that this by states, for states, relative, universally exceptional attitude to human rights is actually the baseline, and not this misguided understanding that these relatively to the Western experience rights are now being interpreted as being truly global. So I think, again, the jury's out on GCI, but it's just begun. It's only been about 6 months. And so I think we can see where things go and be very interesting to track that competition for the UNESCO Advisory Board now to see whether or not there are echoes or replies to noises to do with GCI in that space.
Courtney, you've twice used this term universally exceptional approach. What do you mean? What do you mean by that? Using universally and exceptional together?
Great. So this is an excellent turn of phrase from Nadege Roland. She has, really eaten all the sawdust and produced all the reports for everyone else plowing through that info. I think it's really a response to sometimes there is this view that China is promoting its own unique model for other states to adopt. And I'd say that's only half correct. I think Nadege Roland really has hit the nail on the head, that China's real push rhetorically in this phase is to say that everyone is actually exceptional. All states are exceptional. We have a universal exceptionalism. And if we're all exceptional in our backgrounds and our histories and our problems and our issues that we face, then therefore the solutions and the standards in which we're measured to achieve these solutions, modernity, development, security, are therefore also exceptional. So it's not saying you have to be like China on every measure, but you have to accept the view that China is putting forward, that we all get to be unique. And I think actually, in a lot of ways, that has a lot more play if you're dealing with other players across the system that don't look like you, that you're able to say, but we really understand what your domestic conditions are. We really do interpret and understand where you're coming from. Doesn't this sound a lot better than what Western players will say, that you have to meet these particular standards or these particular notions of accountability? So yeah, thanks.
Interesting. So let's see, Karen, Chris, GCI, any views?
If I can just add one very short point, which is that Courtney very rightly was talking about UNESCO, and it's not just the executive board. It's next year, Audrey Azoulay's term ends. I think it's next year, and I think there's going to be an election, and I understand from my discussions around with people is that it's very possible that China will put forward a candidate to actually be the head of UNESCO, and if that's the case, I would anticipate there being an amped up focus on GCI in that body.
How about you, Karen? How do you think of GCI?
To be very frank, I think GCI as it stands right now is still really like very vague in the way it describes itself. And it is more of a statement of intent rather than a list of concrete measures in how China is going to achieve its cultural, civilizational goals. So I think at this point, this is probably more of a rhetorical tool rather than and it is not a action plan. So how it will evolve will really depend on the follow-ups.
And what do you think the goal of it is? Is it to sort of undermine the belief that there are universal human rights norms? Is it sort of to tear down or not to undermine or replace the liberal aspects of the liberal international order? Is that what it's about?
I wouldn't put it that way. So in the like the Global Civilization Initiative like statement, actually there were discussions of Western capitalist countries having been controlling the modernization discourse, and saying that modernization equalizes westernization. I'm quoting the actual the document. And civilization's diversity determines each country's choice of development pathways diversity. And so I think such language really suggests an attempt to provide an alternative discourse. I wouldn't view it as in engaging with a head-to-head competition, but I think it's really just providing an alternative way in viewing development and in viewing civilization and in viewing just models of development different countries choose.
Okay, I'm going to go to another question. This one's quite interesting, a lot of color. So, quote, I work in the Solomon Islands, where China's development initiative, the Global Security Initiative, and BRI are quite visible. From a health standpoint, China medical teams are embedded in the local medical system long-term, and local doctors and nurses spend time in China getting education. In countries like Solomon Islands, do the panelists have any views on whether China's approach may be more beneficial than conventional aid offered by development partners such as New Zealand, Australia, and recently the United States? Karen, do you want to take that one?
Yeah, sure. Thank you very much for the question. So the Chinese approach to in the medical domain in terms of development cooperation has traditionally been sending medical teams to these countries and providing lots of technical supports and providing detailed guidance. It's an approach of teaching one how to fish rather than giving them the fish. And so from that regard, more hands-on approach can be very helpful. And given China's own development trajectory, some of the medical support actually started from the barefoot doctor history, where China delivers medical support team to different countries, although they were not advanced medical experts, but they provide sufficient, good enough medical support for countries in providing their daily health needs, in meeting their daily health needs. So I think this approach is the Chinese approach could potentially be more cost efficient, and for governments with limited budget, it may be a good option to consider, given that it could serve more people.
Courtney, as an Australian, you're undoubtedly aware of the issue of China's presence in the Solomon Islands and the development aid that Australia has provided. So any thoughts from your perspective?
I think I'll put it this way. I have met many a weary and hardworking DFAT official who I think understandably were worried when certain security pacts were signed, but then also knew to wait a minute because you're dealing with one of the best politicians on the planet. And so Guevara is not going to sign a document today and maybe stay with it, which has been very much Australia's long relationship with the Solomons, is learning how to actually do politics and do it effectively. Whether or not Chinese officials were prepared to have a smaller island official turn around and say, well, actually, wait a minute, I would like to change some of the terms of the agreement, I think we can all read the news on that. But I think, again, this is a very long, complicated relationship. Australia certainly is a effective and large regional presence, but that is all relative, again, to having a much larger and potentially effective player like China entering the space. I will say, though, I think it's very interesting to see the modifications in China's approaches to the Pacific Island Forum. As we all remember, China's first sort of top-down attitude that we have a recommended set of texts, we're all going to go ahead and sign this. And then they were kind of surprised. And officials in Beijing did not realize that there are very, very strong and well-defended normative practices within this group of states for how they deal with questions of their own regional governance. So having perhaps the humility that maybe Australians have learned the hard way actually could be of use. So I think I'll leave those sort of pointed comments as the average Australian right there.
Okay, interesting perspective straight from Sydney. All right, I've got a variety of questions here that basically can be summed up as, given the general preference in Chinese statecraft for bilateral negotiations, how should we expect China to follow through on these big multilateral mechanisms, right? Are the Chinese really going to be able to follow through, or are these mechanisms just a platform for getting, you know, countries in the room with China and negotiating bilaterally? So this is really a question of sort of statecraft and how Chinese traditional statecraft interacts with these initiatives. Chris, do you want to start off on that one?
Sure. I do agree with the idea that China, in my experience, has preferred the bilateral connection with countries and bilateral negotiation. And that's been my experience. But I would say that China has become increasingly, especially since I served at the embassy in Beijing, increasingly active in terms of inviting large groups of countries to Beijing to have meetings on Africa, to have meetings on, you know, the friends of GDI. I think that that given, you know, it's something I'm just thinking of now, is that all of these initiatives and a lot of the added money that's put into the multilateral system, the positions that China has in some of the agencies, gives China some convening power that maybe China didn't have before. And so I think that could be something to keep an eye on. But it, you know, let's just see how it plays out. I think I'd stay with that.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else want to come in on this? Bilateral initiatives versus multilateral ones, how are they going to net out? No? Okay, let's go to the next question. Here's an interesting question. Who in China runs these initiatives? Where do they sit? Are they all in the foreign ministry? What about the development initiatives? Are they in the economic ministries? Good question. I mean, I'm sort of an old student of Chinese bureaucratic politics. Who runs these? Karen, let's start with you. GDI. Where does GDI sit? Where does BRI sit? And how does that affect how these initiatives are going to be implemented?
So the Belt and Road Initiative sits at it's actually a sub-state level, like it's higher than ministry, yet below state level governing body that is governing the Belt and Road Initiative.
So that's a little bit China speak. So even as a China specialist, I'm not entirely sure what you're talking about. So maybe you could give us a name of an organization. Where does BRI sit?
Sure. That's actually a good question, in that there isn't really an institutional home for the Belt and Road.
So it's not the National Development and Reform Commission, otherwise known as the NDRC.
So the joint implementer, the major implementer of the Belt and Road Initiative, are the NDRC, National Development and Reform Commission, Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and Ministry of Commerce. And they are the major constituting body of a Belt and Road leadership small group in the
We know in China world, we know leading small groups. We know them well. Yeah. Yep.
Leading small group. And that is headed by a vice premier.
Which vice premier, Karen?
Remember off the top of my head.
Okay, sorry.
So it's been a long day.
I know. I get it. Yeah. I get it. Too many questions for me. What about GDI? All right. So we get it on BRI, but BRI has been around for a long time. So, of course, the Chinese figured out where to put it. Who runs GDI?
GDI has, from my understanding and based on the documents and the news announcement that I have read, seems to be largely housed with the newly established CITCA, Chinese International Cooperation and Development Agency. And at least based on the list of projects that has been issued from the GDI, those projects are primarily South-South cooperation focusing on development coming from CITCA.
Right. And those are the small, beautiful projects. South-South, small and beautiful. Is that?
I think there is a general shift in not just the GDI, but also even in the Belt and Road Initiative and in Chinese overseas development finance at large, we are seeing a shift in this direction. It's not just the GDI.
I see. Okay. Got it. So Courtney and Chris, coming to you guys now, GSI, where does it sit? Who's responsible for it? Who talks about it? What do you think?
Chris, I'll let you take this one first.
Yeah, I think I wanted to let you take it first. I'm not sure where it sits.
Okay. If you don't know, but
yeah, I don't know.
Does Wang Yi talk about GSI? Who else has given speeches on GSI? Any sense of the bureaucratic structure there?
I think the first speech was at the Boao Forum in April of last year, I guess. I believe Wang Yi spoke about it then. I think that he's at least the spokesperson for it, but where it sits, I'm just not sure.
Okay. That's right.
And I think I'd have to agree with Chris on that. I mean, I think it's important to note that we have, you know, Xi Jinping is on the record discussing it, and that of course is a great political signal, I guess, for, as they say now, the core's intent to sort of discuss and frame this project. I think I would just like to point out one thing though, if we think about where are these institutional homes, maybe unlike GDI that will have a clear base, and like BRI now has developed a clear base, I think GSI, there's a lot more room to play. I think in the sense that even if we look at its multilateral examples, right, you really could be moving to the UN Office of Drug and Crime, you know, Department of Peace Operations, maybe something can go through the Security Council. So I think, you know, you are in this very flexible space. And I think just like many diplomats, retired diplomats on loan to Georgetown will know much better than I will. When there was the $1 billion announcement in 2015 for the Peace and Development Trust Fund, of course, it's been scaled down to 200 million over a decade at 20 million a year, which, let's be frank, in terms of UN dollars, is much rather have the dollars, but 20 million in the UN can go by pretty fast. But I will say, I think it was very interesting that, you know, those working within the UN mission, you know, on behalf of China, were not aware that this figure was coming. So I think we have to also, you know, give credit and give kudos to diplomats that are ready to work on the fly once intent is understood, and that they have to now try and develop and operationalize what these initiatives look like. So I would imagine in this particular example where we are now, a lot more sort of flexibility and open to interpretation practicalities until we are in such a well-developed place, like Karen can give an exact answer to where GDI is based. I think maybe we're still in that opening phase. And so credit has to be given to those Chinese diplomats that are working out exactly what this looks like in practice.
And if I may add, I think it also has to do with the Chinese style of policymaking, making a stylized, very general statement at the beginning, outlining the blueprint, and then followed up with concrete actions through some trial and error in this process. And if I may also connect this to some academic discussions of Chinese globalization and the Belt and Road Initiative. The Belt and Road Initiative has always been described, has been described by some scholars as a form of state mobilized globalization. And it is a process where using globalization, using a global initiative to try to mobilize some of the fragmented parts within the Chinese government and within and the fragmented nature of other Chinese actors. And if we think about GDI, GCI, and GSI in that light, that could also be viewed as state mobilized globalization in various domains. And the extent to which these initiatives would be successful in mobilizing the fragmented pieces and the fragmented initiatives under each goal remains to be seen, since they are still at their very early stage.
Thank you. Well, I believe, Karen, you're referring to Min Ye's excellent work at BU. Yes, she's a good friend of Georgetown University, and we've had her on a couple podcasts. So we're basically running out of time. So let's end with something a little bit more fun, a little less academic. So We've had two big summit meetings in the past couple of weeks, right? Prime Minister Albanese visited China. And of course, Xi Jinping and Joe Biden just met in San Francisco. So why don't we, we've only got 3 minutes left. So I thought maybe we'd end with like just a hot take from Chris first on Biden, Xi Jinping. What do you think it means? And then Courtney, any views you have on Xi and Albo?
So I think my first take, my hot take is that it was a pretty positive meeting. And that the agreements that were reached on fentanyl and also reopening the mill communication is worth noting, and is those are positive steps. You know, it's a very different tone from what we've seen over the last year, and I think that can only be seen as positive for, you know, anyone who cares about stabilizing the relationship between the United States and China. So I think we can, you know, I hope we can look at this as sort of a stepping stone towards maybe some improvement in finding areas where we can cooperate. But look, you know, I don't want to, you know, mislead you into thinking that all of a sudden, you know, we're on the cusp of some sort of, you know, great solving of all of our problems. It's true that the core issues weren't necessarily, you know, dealt with in any sort of creative way. And you know, it's probably not ready for that at this point, but still, I would say that that it was good, and I think it's positive that we can you know, that we can, and that we can look forward and hope that we can build on it.
Thanks, Chris. Very insightful, very balanced. Courtney, how did your prime minister's visit to China go? Do we have a new era in Sino-Australian relations?
I think this was certainly a visit in which both sides were hoping would be a great success. All of the preparatory efforts made by both foreign ministries, checking off their 7-item to-do list to facilitate this happening, China's view that it had done the correct things in order to help promote those conditions. So this was a major issue for many Australians, the unlawful detention of Australians in China. So of course, you know, a very big move to finally see Chung Lei's release. Of course, there are still Australians being held. But I think, again, this was very much seen as an effort on both sides to best understand the cooperate where we can space and maybe leave less of the discussion about the disagree where we must and the interpretations of national interest. And I think really, given how frosty, and that's a very polite use of the word frosty, the relations were, this was certainly seen as sort of a high water point. I think we're again still trying to understand the comments about Albanese being a very handsome boy, if that translation is correct.
Oh, I missed that. Tell us about that.
Well, no, that he had been called that by a Chinese official. And so there was actually a direct question asked of him, you know, sir, how do you interpret that? I'm basically summarizing that question came out by Will Glasgow from the Oz. And of course, Albanese is a politician like any other, and he knew to avoid that question and sort of remark about how Shanghai's development was really quite something. But I think we're all still trying to understand what that remark was getting at. So I think, again, what type of praise does it mean to be a very handsome boy? But yeah.
Interesting. Okay.
Very much
well,
so.
On that note, Courtney Fung, Chris Klein, Karen Ju, thank you so much. I've put you all through the ringer, asked you lots of hard questions, and you've answered them very, very diligently. But most importantly, I think we've really created some value here. We've dug in on three very challenging, difficult to interpret new Chinese initiatives, and hopefully created a much more sort of level understanding of what these new initiatives are, how they might evolve, etc. So thanks so much for joining us. Thanks everybody who's watched today or in the future. And again, we're the Georgetown University's Asian Studies Department and our U.S.-China Dialogue on Global Issues. We do these webinars with academic experts regularly, so please come back and join us. Thanks, everybody.